when you show up for work after coming from Mass, if you do. Let them know what your prayer life means to you, you know, how much you lean on the Blessed Virgin Mary, you know, what her presence in your life means to you, what the Blessed Sacrament means to you. You know, there's nothing offensive in letting them know, you know, the joy and the peace that you know through the Jewish Messiah, Jesus, right? And there's nothing offensive in letting them know that as far as you see as a Catholic, Jesus was a Jew, and it was Jews who brought salvation to the world through their Jewish Messiah. So thank you very much, co-worker, you know. I mean, that stuff cannot possibly be offensive, and it can't help but mark them, you know. And everybody wants to be happy, and everybody wants to know peace, and most people actually want to know God. And if you let Jews know that that is what you have as a Catholic, they may reject you at that point in time, or they may think, well, you know, what do you expect? This is just, you know, some, you know, crazy, superstitious, medieval Catholic. But they're not going to forget, right? I mean, in other words, they're going to be moved by the peace and the joy that they see in you, and they're going to want it. So that's a very safe way to evangelize. But anyway, this is, again, a digression, but what I was really saying was the Catholic Church used to really have a different attitude towards the evangelization of the Jews. I mentioned those two Jewish twin brothers, the Lehman brothers. By the way, their story is also in this book. Now, they circulated a postulatum at the First Vatican Council. A postulatum is essentially a petition. This petition was hardly endorsed by Pope Pius IX, who was the Pope of the Council. The First Vatican Council took place in the late 1860s. It was signed by virtually all of the church fathers at the Council, virtually all of the Council fathers, rather, all of the bishops at the Council. In fact, the only bishops who were reluctant to sign it were bishops who read it and said, oh no, we can't do this, because if the Jews convert, it'll be the second coming and the end of the world. And even they, I mean, the Lehman brothers convinced them to sign it too, because that's what God wanted. But anyway, so here's this petition, which was endorsed by Pius IX, signed by all of the Council Fathers, virtually all of the Council Fathers at the First Vatican Council, and it's a prayer for the conversion of the Jews. And I'm gonna close with it, and then I'll take a couple of questions. I'll close with it, reading it as a prayer. I invite you to follow along praying it if you feel so moved to. And at my table out there, I have prayer cards with this on the back for free. You'll have a picture of the Lehman Brothers on the front, and it has this postulatum on the back, you know, if you want to walk off with it. So here's the postulatum for the First Vatican Council. The undersigned fathers of the Council humbly, yet urgently, beseechingly pray that the Holy Ecumenical Council of the Vatican come to the aid of the unfortunate nation of Israel with an entirely paternal invitation, that it express the wish that, finally exhausted by a weight no less futile than long, the Israelites hasten to recognize the Messiah, our Savior, Jesus Christ, truly promised to Abraham and announced by Moses, thus completing and crowning, not changing, the Mosaic religion. The undersigned fathers have the very firm confidence that the Holy Council will have compassion on the Israelites, because they are always very dear to God on account of their fathers, and because it is from them that the Christ was born according to the flesh. Would that they then speedily acclaim the Christ, saying, Hosanna to the Son of David, blessed be he who comes in the name of the Lord. Would that they hurl themselves into the arms of the Immaculate Virgin Mary, even now their sister according to the flesh, who wishes likewise to be their mother according to grace, as she is ours. Amen.
Amen.
And thank you. I only have time, I guess, for one or two questions, if I do. Yes?
What do you think about the Holocaust that has made us quit praying for the conversion of Jews?
Well, I mean, I could be coy and say, in a way, you're in a better position to answer that than I am. But from the Jewish side, I mean, it's very obvious, look, that the Jewish authorities, just like they did in Jesus' day, by the way, are dead set against the evangelization of the Jews, right? I mean, that's total anathema. There is nothing more offensive to, you know, Abe Foxman of the Anti-Defamation League than any evangelization of the Jews. And they will very readily use the Holocaust, right, as a club the instant anything hints of evangelization, right? They will come back and they will say, you know, to the Christian involved or the Catholic involved, how dare you after the Holocaust? As though there is some kind of moral equivalence between trying to bring people, you know, to the Messiah that they brought to the world, right? To bring them to the joy of full union with God and exterminating them in Auschwitz, right? But that is what the, you know, Abe Foxmans of the world will say. And the problem is, in today's politically correct, don't defend anybody, you know, and kind of don't make waves attitude, it's too tempting, you know, for the, I don't know what to say it, but for the party on the other side to back off and say, okay, I'll go back into a hole and I'll forget about this. Instead of saying, you know, this isn't about the Holocaust, this isn't about persecution, this isn't about doing any injustice to the Jews. This is about, you know, bringing, you know, this is about charity, you know. And not a whole lot of people, you know, have the stomach to take that posture. And I can do it because I can get away with it, right? Because it's hard for people to call me anti-Semitic. But, you know, I'm in a privileged position, and I understand why it's very hard for a cradle Catholic to stand up to that kind of opposition. But I think that's in some sense why what I'm doing is kind of needed. And I've gone around to a number of bishops. By the way, you have, I mean, you're very blessed, you and Phoenix, good bishop. Very blessed. And actually gotten some bishops, including Bishop Olmsted, to be enthusiastic about at least opening up like an office in the chancery for Jews who are inquiring about the Catholic faith, right? You know, you don't have to evangelize. Like when I became Catholic, it took me like 3 years to discover that there had ever in history been another Jew who had entered the Catholic Church. I would call the chancery and try to find just some way of finding out about other Jews who are Catholic. And they would refer me to the Catholic Jewish dialogue people, who are about the opposite. You know, they're about arguing why there's no reason for Jews to convert. So that there should be at least a welcome, like a welcome mat out in the Catholic Church. I mean, it doesn't have to be, you know, this aggressive net that you cast over the head of Jews, but at least a welcome mat. But anyway, and Bishop Olmsted was very positive about that, by the way. That was, I guess, the answer to your question, I hope. Only this has to be the last question, although I'll come back. Somebody said something about 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning we'll be here. I'll be here at 1 o'clock in the morning. Anybody who wants, have another 2 hours. Yeah?
When we talk about the Holocaust, all of us, of course, think of the 6 million Jewish people who were massacred at that time, and some of us have been to Auschwitz and Bergen. But there were almost a million Catholic, Polish, and German people, and yet I never hear, except for, you know, Max Benny and Kolbe and Edith Stein, I never hear the Jewish people discuss the Catholic-Christian type people who also were massacred.
Yeah, that's true. Well, there is a lot of anti-Christianity and anti-Catholicism among Jews. It's not just anti-Semitism among Catholics. And it is absolutely true that especially, especially the Jews should acknowledge the Catholics and the Christians who were persecuted for essentially not going along with the Nazis and so forth. And I don't know what the number is, but I think it's several million Polish Catholics who were also exterminated. But there was still a qualitative difference, I will argue, which is the Jews were exterminated only for being Jews. In other words, it was in... I mean, it's really not very nice even to say, but the Poles, it was a tremendous number of Polish Catholics who were killed, and there were several categories of why they were killed. Sometimes they were killed because the Germans wanted their land, right? I mean, the Nazis had a plan to exile one-third of the Poles and kill one-third of the Poles and essentially enslave the remaining third of the Poles. Great, so the reason was different. The reason was because they wanted Poland, you know, as opposed to that they wanted to eradicate Polish blood from the face of the earth. It doesn't help much if you're one of, you know, the inmates of Auschwitz. But it's still, there still was a purpose to the Holocaust aimed at the Jews, which was different from the purpose aimed at the non-Jews. But other than that, you're absolutely right. And there was a tremendous amount of heroism on the part of the Christians in the face of the Holocaust, which is not properly acknowledged. You know, by the Jews in the Holocaust industry. Anyway, I do have to stop before the hook comes out, but thank you very much.